Thank you for choosing to watch this sermon preached at Heritage Baptist Church. Heritage Baptist Church is located at 1843 Peeksville Road, Locust Grove, Georgia, 30248. You can contact us at 770-320-7771. Visit us on the web at www.hbcga.com.
I want you to open your Bibles with me. We're going to go to a few scriptures, but go to 1 Samuel chapter 17. 1 Samuel chapter 17. 1 Samuel chapter 17. We're going to look at one thing that took place right here, really a statement that ended up being made. Then we're going to go to another place in the Old Testament. We're going to go over to the book of Daniel, and we're going to see a couple of things there, and then we'll end up in the New Testament, all right? But all of this, if we read 1 Samuel right here, this is the story of David and Goliath. And you know the story. The Philistines set their army in array against the children of Israel, and they brought their champion out, this huge giant. Just a humongous man, got on all the armor, a trained warrior from his youth, and he comes out and he says to all the army of Israel, give me a man that we may fight together. Now, my wife says that is her verse, you know. She claims that as a Bible verse. And y'all, that was funny, y'all. You should have laughed at that. Give me a man that we may fight together. Anyway, she likes that verse. And but right here, though, he's calling out. He's calling everybody out. And the king of Israel, Saul, was scared. So was everybody else. The Bible says that they were they were afraid. The Bible says in verse 24 that all the men of Israel, when they saw the man, fled from him and were sore afraid. And brother, you can imagine there's this king, by then he's probably mocking the king, mocking everybody else. Well, David comes to bring some food to his brothers, and he hears this guy. And here's brother, when he hears what he says, then the Bible says in verse 26, David spake to the men that stood by him, saying, what shall be done to the man that killeth this Philistine and taketh away the reproach from Israel? For who is this uncircumcised Philistine that he should defy the armies of the living God? And the people answered him and said, oh, this will be done or that'll be done. His older brother came, Eliab, in verse 28, his eldest brother, when he heard that he spake unto the men, his anger was kindled against David. And he said, why camest thou down hither? And with whom hast thou left those few sheep in the wilderness? I know thy pride, the naughtiness of thine heart, for thou art come down that thou mightest see the battle. Now notice what David said, and this is where I wanted to get to. And David said, what have I now done? Is there not a cause? Now, what David was saying was, David said, guys, there's something worth fighting for right here. This is a fight that needs to be done. Somebody needs to step up and fight this champion. Now, David was right. There was a cause to fight right there. Over in the book of Daniel, if we were reading there, there's several things that take place. Young Daniel was taken captive. He's now a captive over in a foreign land. And they've taken the best of the best of the children of Israel, and they're going to use them. They're going to train them up, and they're going to use them to benefit that kingdom there. Well, they bring in the king's wine and the king's food. Well, obviously, Daniel was old enough that he was taught right, that you don't, there are certain foods you didn't eat, and certainly you don't drink and do all of that. And so what happened was is they brought him in and said, you're going to do that. And he said, look, he said, I don't want to do that. He said, I purposed in my heart that I'll keep myself clean. He said, I want to do right. In other words, he was looking at what they were asking him to do, but he looked at his purity, and he said, my purity is worth more than committing this sin that I'd be doing if I ate this food and drank this drink. In fact, you know the story. They didn't drink. They ate the other food, and after 10 days, they came back, and the children of Israel and Daniel and all of them, they were fairer and fatter, the Bible said. Man alive, they were some chunky monkeys right there. Brother, they were looking good. Amen. And so you say, well, thin is in. Yeah, but fat's where it's at, baby. Amen. I'm telling you, that's good right there too, y'all. Amen. Can I just say, you know what Daniel was saying? Hey, there's some things worth standing for. We could read in this same chapter or this same book and go over when the three Hebrew children were going to get thrown into the burning fiery furnace. And they said, hey, you're going to bow down to this idol. And you bow or you're going to burn. And you know what? They stood. They would not bow. And because they would not bend, they would not bow. By the way, they did not burn when they were thrown into the fire. Amen. But you know what they said? They said, wait a minute now. This violates our Christian principles. We only bow to God. We are not to bow down to some other idol. You understand? And so what the three Hebrew children said is just like David said and just like Daniel said. They said, there's some things that are worth standing for, some things that are worth fighting for. Now I want you to turn with me, if you will, to 2 Timothy. Go to 2 Timothy chapter 4. 2 Timothy chapter 4. With that in mind, we come down to the Apostle Paul at the end of his life. Oh, this good man of God, this great man of God. Oh, he has written over half the New Testament, started churches all across that region of land over there in the Middle East. The early churches now. All these churches that you read about in Ephesus and Philippi, I mean, they're places that he has gone and preached and he won people to the Lord. And now churches are in those places. Now, the Bible says this, if we read 2 Timothy chapter 4, and look with me, if you will, down let's just start reading in verse 5. But watch thou in all things, endure afflictions, do the work of an evangelist, make full proof of thy ministry. For I am now ready to be offered, and the time of my departure is at hand. I have fought a good fight. I have finished my course. I have kept the faith. Henceforth, there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give me at that day, and not to me only, but also unto them that all them that love his appearing. You know what he said? He said, I have fought a good fight. Now, did you know that in this same book right here in chapter 2, the Bible said, thou therefore, my son, be strong, that is in the grace that is in the grace that is in Christ Jesus, and the things that thou hast heard of me among many witnesses, the same commit thou to faithful men. By the way, God's still committing those things to faithful men. Amen. God is still committing these truths to faithful men who shall be able to teach others also. Then the Bible says this. He goes on and says, thou therefore endure hardness as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. Sounds to me like we are in God's army. We are soldiers. And brother, with that in mind, Paul had said, I fought a good fight. Paul is saying, there is a good fight to fight. There's some things worth fighting for. And I say amen to that this morning. Brother, when I began to look, by the way, you know the devil is real. I said the devil is real. He's not some red suit, pitchfork guy, pointed tail and all of that. Man, you saw some kind of deviled ham and saw that, and that's what you think of the devil. No, that's not the devil at all. Brother, we've got some real enemies that we got to fight, and the devil's one of them. And you understand the devil's not, he's not playing around with this thing. He's for real. You may play around with it, but the devil don't. You may play around with your marriage, but the devil don't. You may play around with raising your family, but the devil don't. We may play around with church, but the devil don't. Man, the devil don't at all. See, the devil, he's in this thing for keeps. He understands he's on a short leash. He's got a limited amount of time with what he does. By the way, you understand this matter of the battle that we're in. We're in such a battle right now. Brother, the devil, I mean, he is hand-to-hand combat with you on a daily basis. You fight the devil. You battle with the devil. But we battle several things, too. I'll lay all of that out to you. But when I think about it, though, he's after, if you're lost, he is after your soul. You know that, don't you? If you're not saved, the battle is on for your soul. He wants to do whatever he can to keep you from going to heaven. He wants you to go to hell when you die. He wants to make sure you don't hear the gospel. And if you hear the gospel, he wants you to put it off. Don't get saved now. Don't trust Christ now, because he wants you to die one day and burn in hell. That's what the devil wants for you. By the way, you say, preacher, I'm saved. You preaching that, that doesn't really do anything to me. How about all your family? How about all your family? You see, because the devil, if he has his way, brother, they'll bust hell wide open if he has his way. They'll never hear about Christ. They'll never put their faith in Christ. They won't get saved. They'll die, and for all eternity, brother, they'll beg and burn in the charred walls of hell. And I could not imagine somebody going to hell, but certainly not my family. But the devil's after my family. The devil's after your family. The devil's after not just our family. The devil's after your faith if you're saved. He can't do anything about you getting saved and being born again. So what is he going to do? Let's make sure that God's people are nominal, subpar Christians. Let's just make sure they don't ever do anything for God. Let's make sure they just show up to church but never get active. Let's make sure they come, but they just don't, you know, they don't get involved. You know, hands off. Let's just make, oh, you're saved, you're going to heaven. And the devil can't do a thing about that. But see, he's doing his job well if all we are spectators at the house of God. Can I tell you, God doesn't want you being a spectator. He wants you being a participator. Man, he wants you involved with it. He wants you serving. He wants you living. He wants you just giving and going and growing. He wants all of that in your Christian life. But if we're not careful, and you know what? Maybe we even join the church. Man, I'm saved, and I came down, preacher, and I joined that church. Hey, I did too one day. Whenever we came down, I've only been a member of two churches in my life. That's the church where I got saved at, and this one right here. Amen. I was there 16 years, and I've been here now. It'll be 18 years in January. Man, can you believe that? That is a long time for a man to be in one place, ain't it, buddy? Yeah, he's like, yeah, you're old. Amen. But can I say this? Hey, you understand, the Lord put us here, but I'm glad that I don't want to just be somebody that says, here's the devil again. Devil says, all right, you've joined that church. I can't stop that. You're a member of the Heritage Baptist Church. I can't do anything about that, but again, let's just keep you on a bench. In fact, let's don't even get you back on Wednesday night or Sunday night or Sunday school. Let's just make sure you're one of those, hey, you come on Sunday mornings, that's fine, but let's just keep it like that. Right. Satan, oh man, you can't tell me he doesn't want that. You can't tell me the devil doesn't say, let's keep them coming as little as possible and getting around that Word of God as little as possible and being around the Spirit of God as little as possible, because he does not want you to grow. He doesn't want you growing in the Lord. He doesn't want you strong in the grace that is in Christ Jesus. Now, you can be strong, and the Lord wants you growing, but you understand, the devil, if he has his way, you see, he always wants the least in our life. He doesn't want you to get saved, but if you ever get saved, he doesn't want you joining the church. If you ever join the church, he doesn't want you by the way, if you've been saved and you hadn't been baptized, he just wants to keep you from obeying the Lord. Because he knows even that act of obedience in getting baptized, man, that's a blessing, and that's right. By the way, if you've been saved, you ought to get baptized. Baptism doesn't get you to heaven when you die, but it's like my wedding ring right here. My wedding ring doesn't make me married. If that was the case, if I took it off, then I wouldn't be married. Number one, I can't get it off, amen. It ain't been off in for years, amen. Now, I understand, guys. I know, preacher, now, I'll tell you what, if I wore my ring, I work on a job, and if I got it caught in a piece of machinery, it'd tear my finger off. Hey, hold up that bloody nub, and she'll be like, I love that man right there. He had my ring on. Amen. No, I'm kidding. You do whatever you want to do. I'm just saying, I can't get mine off. It's staying, all right? And then I get out in the sun, I turn into an Indian anyway. So look, if I took it off, I still got it on anyway. It's right there. Amen. But you understand, the devil, he wants the least. He wants the least you can give. He wants the least you can do. Stay at this place. If you get saved, don't get baptized. If you get baptized, don't join the church. If you join the church, just come once in a while. And then if you start coming a little bit more, well, come, but don't get involved. And if you're gonna, that's in everything. If they're gonna go visit, well, you know, think about the Lord, but don't ever pass out a track. And if you're gonna pass out a track, well, don't invite anybody. If you're going to invite somebody, well, don't tell them about Jesus. And if you're going to, don't be a soul winner. You see, he's trying to keep you from that. Right. Offering plate passes. Just, hey, throw in a little bit. Throw in what you feel. You know, you feel around everything but a dime. Whoa, yeah. Whoa, amen. Hey, help yourself. But if you're going to do that, he'll say, well, if you're going to give a little, don't do it regular. And if you're going to just give a little bit regular, well, certainly don't tithe. Oh, my goodness. And if you're going to tithe, well, then don't give above that and beyond to like missions or to anything else. You see, let's just keep it minimal. Keep it, hey, stay on the down low. That's what the devil wants. Now, I'm just telling you, I'm preaching on the good fight, right? You got three enemies in your life. And the Bible tells us about all three of them, all right? I'm preaching on the devil first. I need to be, really, he was my last person in my outline, all right? But I guess I'm already dealing with him a little bit, amen? But you're going to face that. You got the world, the flesh, and the devil. You got the world, the flesh, and the devil. You got a threefold enemy that is after you. By the way, he's after your marriage. Preacher, we're a good family. We're in an independent Baptist church. We love the Lord. God's put us in a good church, under a good pastor, with good people. And man alive, my marriage is secure. Then how in the world in 18 years have people gotten divorce after divorce sitting right there on those pews where you sit? Amen. Oh, preacher, the devil, that can't happen to me. Wait, world, flesh, and the devil can get a hold of anybody. Right. I said the world, flesh, and the devil can get a hold of anybody. I've seen Christians that have been on fire, and I mean, brother, they've been in church, and I mean, buddy, they didn't miss a service, and they got involved, and they were serving God, but now they're not even in church. They're out, and they're living worldly again. What happened? World, flesh, and the devil got them. Got them. Hey, a lot stronger men than I am. Hey, a lot stronger men than I am as far as spiritually. See, the Bible tells us over in the Old Testament in Proverbs, I believe it says, yea, many strong men have been slain by her. Talking about sin. And I'm just telling you, we have to understand that, hey, Satan, we're no match for any of that other than through the Word of God and what I want to show you this morning. But the Bible says that we don't have to be ignorant of Satan's devices. Let me give you that verse. I said something on the devil. I'm just going to preach on the devil first. Amen. Let's go to the end of the message and lay that out. But just remember, the Bible says in 1 Peter 5:8, be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, as a roaring lion, walketh about, seeking whom he may devour. Think about it. A lion. Who does the lion attack? He attacks the weak. He attacks the wandering. Spiritually, he attacks the worldly, you understand? Now, that's on the weak side of it. But let me turn it around on the other side. Hey, he doesn't stop there. The Bible says this, yea, and all that will live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution. Man, the devil, I tell you who he'll go after also on the flip side of that. He goes after the godly. He goes after the givers, the goers, those that are growing. Man, he goes after everybody. The truth is, every one of us have a bullseye on our back if you are born again and you're a child of God. Satan hates God with a passion. His pride lifted him up. God had to cast him down. Brother, he is no match for God. So, how does he attack God? Through the thing that God loves more than anything. Me and you. He can't get to God any other way except to do it through us. He can't shame God any other way except to shame God through us. He can't hurt God any other way than to hurt us. You understand? Because we're his people, man. We're his children, and he loves us. So Satan says, I can't stand that crowd. So as a roaring lion, he walketh about, seeking whom he may devour. And brother, it's a sad thing to see the families that God's devoured, to see the teenagers that God's devoured, to see the men and the women that God's devoured. Oh, brother, it breaks your heart when you realize what's going on. I just say this, though. The only thing I can say about the devil's attack is we need to recognize it. The Bible says in 1 Peter 5:9, or he tells us, I'm sorry, in 2 Corinthians 2:11, lest Satan should get an advantage of us, for we are not ignorant of his devices. Now, Satan's been going after people for a long time, is what I'm telling you, and he's not about to stop today. But you and I, thank God, he's got an arsenal of the world and our flesh, and he uses those two things to attack us. You understand? The world is that which is outside, and our flesh is that which is inside. So he's got an internal attack and an external attack that takes place on mine and your lives on a daily basis. Now, my job as a pastor, the reason I'm preaching on this morning is I want you to be able to see when the devil's coming after you. I want you to be able to biblically and scripturally defend against attack of the devil. Man, I don't want the devil to get another family. Man, I don't want the devil to get another kid. I don't want him to get another teenager. Hey, no doubt about it, brother, but it happens if we shut our eyes and say, well, the devil's over here. He ain't coming my way. How many of you have ever felt like, man, preacher, I tell you, there's been times in my life where I felt like I was battling the devil himself? Be honest. Raise your hand. Let's see. I mean, brother, now, it may have been in your life. It might have been in your marriage. It could have been with your children. It could have been anywhere. I mean, that spiritual attack that we have, we got to understand, man, that's not flesh, the flesh on this world. We think, oh, so-and-so is my enemy. No, devil's your enemy. Now, he might be using so-and-so to try to, goad you some or attack you some. I understand that. He can use people, but this devil, the Bible tells us to do one thing with the devil. It doesn't tell us that we can beat the devil on our own. It doesn't tell us that we have more power than Satan. It does not tell us that us on our own, by ourselves, that we have any ability to be able to withstand all of this other than to do this. The Bible says again in 1 Peter 5:9, he said that, be sober, be vigilant, in 5:8, because your adversary, the devil, is a roaring lion, walks about seeking whom he may devour. But then the rest of the next verse says, whom resist steadfast in the faith. James 4:7, submit yourself therefore unto God. Resist the devil and he will flee from you. Can I say this? Don't give in and roll over. I mean, brother, like a little puppy dog every time the devil comes, amen. I tell you, brother, we can resist that. I'm just saying, we just say no. We just say, no, I'm not going to go there. No, I'm not watching that. No, I'm not going to act like that. No, I'm not living like that. You understand? God's people ought to say no when the devil comes knocking on their door. Oh, preacher, I've fallen a many a time when he's knocked on my door. Well, everybody here has it one time or another. I heard one preacher say it best. He said, when the devil comes knocking at your door, he said, let Jesus answer it. I mean, send the Lord to the door. Amen. Lord, I can't. Lord, temptation's coming my way. And I mean, the devil's knocking on my door. What am I going to do? Jesus said, you just stay right there. I'll go to the door and answer it. Amen. You send the Lord to the door. Lord, you go. By the way, Lord's not going to let him in. Amen. Lord's not going to invite him in. Lord's not going to open that door. Lord's just going to say, hey, get thee behind me, Satan. Amen. Now, I want to show you something right here, though. Let me give you this. Hey, you're going to battle if you're saved. It's just a battle that goes on. But Satan is going to use those two things, internal and external. He uses that external. He uses what we call the world, okay? The world. Now, preacher, you talking about the globe? Are you talking about, continents and oceans? No. I'm talking about this world, the worldly people here. We use the word worldly often. The world is like this world. It's anything sinful. It's anything wicked. It's anything carnal. It can be, hey, there are sinful, wicked, and carnal people. There are sinful, wicked, and carnal places. There's sinful, wicked, and carnal movies. There's sinful, wicked, and carnal music. There's sinful, wicked, and carnal language. There's sinful, wicked, and carnal video games. Kids. There's sinful, wicked, and carnal clothing. There's sinful, wicked, and carnal. You understand, you can put that sinful, wicked, and carnal, and you can put just about anything after that. Your phone can be sinful, wicked, and carnal. Your computer can be sinful, wicked, and carnal. Your TV can be sinful, wicked, and carnal. Your radio can be sinful, wicked, and carnal. Now, you understand, the world, hey, you're bomb blasted with the world every day of your life. I'm just telling you, everywhere you go. You go to Ingles trying to buy, groceries and stuff. I went in there yesterday, man, I tell you, I'm trying to get that stuff right. I get some of that guacamole dip. Man, that lady makes out a guacamole dip at Ingles on the weekends. They got mild and hot. I get that mild. I don't want them jalapenos in there. Me and Miss Felicia, we like that. And we went down to that chip section and got them gluten-free chips, amen, trying to eat right. Oh, my goodness. These things taste like cardboard. But they're gluten-free, amen. It's supposed to be good for you, I reckon, all right. And then what else? I got that, and something else. I can't remember. Anyway, so I'm just going in to grab some guac and get out of there. And I'm walking into that thing, and all of a sudden, I'm heading down to that cash register. Well, what do they put on either side of the cash registers? Oh, my goodness. All the crazy, the National Enquirer. Elvis came back again. I'm like, what? Elvis who? He's gone, man. Who was it? Brother Bob Gray. He was on a flight one time, and he was on there with a bunch of Elvis impersonators. And I mean, brother, they're all in their white suits, and they're like, hey, got all their little, all their sunglasses on, and, they're all on there doing stuff. And they're all standing up doing their stuff, and they're all cracking up, and they're applauding and all this. And he said, hey, he said, I've got an Elvis impersonator. They looked, they said, go ahead, man. And he went like this. He said, they all, ah, yeah. I mean, they're crazy. I mean, you understand, this matter of the world's everywhere. I mean, man, you walk down those aisles, and all of a sudden, they've got nasty, quite crazy stuff there. And then they got some lady trying to advertise deodorant. She ain't got hardly a stitch of nothing on. I'm just telling you, man, you got to walk through the aisle. Hey, I'm serious. You walk through the aisle like this. Hey, that's a nice ceiling they got at Ingles. Here, lady, here's my stuff. Tell me how much it is. Here's my wallet. Just get it out. I'll be back in a little while. Now, wait! It's because the devil's bomb, just wham. Throwing it, hey, everywhere around you. Oh, preacher, that stuff, that don't bother me. Well, you're either more of a man or lesser of one than I am. Amen. You know, I'm just saying, man, hey, you understand, Satan knows what he's doing. He knows where he's at. This matter of the world, you see, there's only so much you can do. The devil, he knows what his job is. He's going to use the world, like the Bible says in John 10:10. It says, the thief cometh not before to steal, to kill, and to destroy. I said a little while ago, hey, we're not on a playground. Hey, you understand? We're on a battleground. The devil say he would love for us just to think, oh, well, it's all right. We're just on that playground. It's little stuff, you know, no big deal. But if you're not careful, here's what you do, we have in the day that we live. We have worldly mamas and worldly daddies. Now, they want their kids living for God, but they live worldly, they act worldly, they dress worldly, they go worldly, they do worldly. And here's the thing. They have no argument when the kids are like, well, you do it. Well, you talk like you say it. Well, you do. You watch it. You go, and see, if we're not careful, oh, we're going to pull the adult thing. Well, don't do as I say. Yeah. Hey, how's that working for you? See, what needs to change is mom and daddy need to get godly instead of being worldly. Amen. Preacher, you're the same old preacher. Yeah, Miss Millie's here. So, same old preacher. Amen. Need to hear it again. Amen. Here's the deal. If I don't preach it, who's going to say it to you? Nobody, hey, obviously a husband don't say it to his wife and a wife don't say it to her husband. You know, they don't, I'll tell you what, when's the last time a husband said to his wife, honey, you're too worldly. It's awful quiet. Bunch of cowards. Well, you say it for me, preacher. I just don't know if I could say that. No, you can't, because how worldly you are. But when's the last time a wife truly called out her husband and said, why aren't you living more godly? You sure are a worldly husband. I didn't marry that. I don't want that. I want godly. It gets awful quiet because husbands and wives don't say that to each other, sadly. Husbands and wives don't talk about the fact that they ought to be living godly and they ought to be the example for their children like they ought to be. See, you thought, man, preacher, I thought you were going to get on them teenagers a little while and preach on them teenagers. You've been with them all week. And I have. Man, I tell you, we've been with it, and I mean, enjoy it. And by the way, it seems like the harder you preach, the more they come to the altar. Amen. So it seems like the harder you preach, the more they come. You know what's wrong with teenagers in the day we live? The lack of hard preaching. But wait a minute, preacher. They need that. By the way, I need that. You need that. Somebody's got to preach against the world. What do we want to say? Let's all live like the world. Let's be like the world. No, somebody's got to cry out against that. And I'm just telling you, brother, God cries out against it in his word. And all I'm doing, look, this is nothing new. This is nothing new for what I'm saying. I'm simply echoing what my God says. And what I'm telling you is, what I'm asking you to do is let the word of God, this matter being worldly, the Bible tells us what not to do with the world. Turn if you will, let's see first. Go to Romans chapter 12. Go to Romans chapter 12. Because that's really where it starts, I believe. Before you start acting something out, before you start talking like it, going there, doing that, here's what happens. Satan. He said the thief cometh not before to steal, to kill, and to destroy. Let me tell you what he's going to do first, church. He will steal your heart. He'll steal your heart. What do you mean, preacher? Look in Romans chapter 12 and see what the Bible says. In verse 1 it says, I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that ye present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. But in verse 2 it says this, and, okay, do all of verse 1, but and, it says, and be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind. Right. Now, what I say right there is, see, the devil's trying to show us this matter of looking like the world. He shows us this matter of, if we're not careful, we want to linger. We want to be around that crowd. And then the Bible tells us in 1 John, here, hold your hand in Romans 12 and go to 1 John chapter 2. 1 John, not John, but 1 John chapter 2. Right there before the book of Revelation. Look right there. 1 John chapter 2. You see, he's got to get your heart. He wants you to love, listen, he wants you to love this old world. He wants you to love that old, here, I got saved, y'all. I mean, I got saved and our family was as wicked as anybody's family could have ever been. Everything in it was wrong. All that stuff I'm preaching about as far as the world, those worldly words came out of everybody's mouth in our entire family. You name it. And put the blank there. That was what our family was when we came to Christ. Hey, worldly movies, worldly music, worldly talking, worldly dress, worldly places, worldly people. Man, there's people all around our house. They sold drugs. Well, not sold it. They really did it out of our house. I mean, people came over. It was a terrible situation, all right? There's nothing to brag on with all of that. That's just what was going on, all right? So everything was wrong in our family. So I think when we got saved, it was very easy for our family to see that wickedness and to realize, man, there's a lot of stuff that God needs us to turn from, and we need to start going in the other direction. Amen? But I can tell you this, the reason we did all of that, let me go ahead and tell you, we loved it. Yep. Amen. Why do you think we listened to that old music? We loved it. Yep. Loved it. You know, we love that old timey rock and roll. Whatever. All that old stuff. I'm sorry, I put that in your mind now. Now you're thinking it while I'm trying to preach. You know. Hey, wait a minute. We listened to all that. We loved it. Why did we watch what we watched? We loved it.
That's exactly right.
We were a product of the world. We looked like the world, act like the world, talk like the world. And you know what? We loved it, and therefore, we lived it. Right. Here's what happened whenever we got saved. We realized our love has to change.
That's right.
We got to start loving God more than we love this world. And the Bible says that we're predestinated to be conformed to the image of Christ. Now, that's what God says. His goal for you is to be Christ-like. His goal, brother, is Christ-like. Not preacher-like, not this one-like, that one-like. It's to be Christ-like in your life. That's what God wants if he has his way. So I want you to think about this now. That being the case, if the Lord wants you to be Christ-like, he wants you to be conformed to the image of Christ. To be conformed is to be molded to that image. Imagine Jesus Christ, and we're able to take and we put clay around his hand, and it molded around his fingers and around the hole that is in his hand where he was crucified for us. And they took that off, and it was a perfect mold of the hand of Christ. That's conforming to the image, that physical image. But the Lord's doing more than that. He said, I want you to conform to the godly image of my son, Jesus. Bible says, as he is holy, so be ye holy. In other words, this matter of conforming is we've got the one to be conformed to. The Lord, he's given us the mark. He showed us what and who we need to be conformed to. But here's what he said. He doesn't just tell you who to be conformed to. He tells us what we do not need to be conformed to. That verse I read a minute ago in Romans, here's what I get out of this, all right? He tells us first in 1 John, are you there? I'd ask you to turn to 1 John. Let me read that to you. Love not the world. Now, there's enough. If you don't know the rest of the verse, everybody say that with me. Love not the world. Love not the world. You say, oh, see, some of you won't even say it, man. What is going on, man? We are so worldly, we won't even say it. Preacher, yeah, oh, preacher, come on now. You're just trying to, no, I'm trying to get it. Man, say it. Quote it. Love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. If any man love the world, here you go. The love of the Father is not in him. Well, now, oh, wait, preacher, you've gone too far. You're telling me I don't love God. You love the world? The Bible says you don't love God. Tear that out of your Bible. Tear it up, crumble it up, get you a Bic lighter, burn it up. But it ain't going to make it not so. You saying, oh, I don't believe that. I don't like all that worldly preaching. And by the way, every once in a while somebody, well, you're preaching about not being worldly. That's legalism. Hey, hogwash, amen. That ain't legalism. Legalism is adding works to salvation. Legalism is me telling you got to live a certain way to be saved. Hey, you hear me? That's legalism. They got nothing to do with you living godly. Come on now. You understand? What I see here is love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. If any man love the world, the love of the Father is not in him. Then he explains it. For all that's in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life are not of the Father, but are of the world. The lust of the flesh is a lust to do something that's wrong. The lust of the eyes is a lust to have something God don't want you to have. And then the Bible says, and the pride of life, that's a lust to be something God don't want you to be. And then, by the way, he reminds us, you know, he just kind of throws in the next verse like, oh, by the way, all that stuff, you're living for the world, you're loving the world. He says, and the world passeth away with the lust thereof. Everything you, wouldn't it be bad to live for all of that? And then one day God says, chunk, and it's gone. So what God is saying there is, there's three things there. Number one, don't love the world. Love not the world. Number two, don't look like the world. And be not conformed to this world. See, loving is in your heart. That's where you got to fix that. But what we love, that's expressed on the outside of our life. Right. Everybody sees it. Yep. Everybody hears it. I mean, that's what you are. If you're worldly, then it's because you're loving the world on the inner heart. By the way, if you're godly, guess who you love in your heart? You're loving God. And that's showing up on the outside. It shows up with the words that come out of your mouth. It shows up with everything, all that, the people, the places, everything. It's not, hey, by the way, some people got this idea of being godly. Well, you're godly if if some lady, if she don't wear, mini skirts and she wears a long skirt now. Y'all, I know some of those wicked women I've known wear long skirts. Don't get this idea that wearing skirts makes you godly. Well, come on, preacher. Hey! Now, you know, it don't make you ungodly, but it don't make you godly. But I can tell you this, you wear a mini skirt, get you some more clothes on, woman. Amen. Nobody needs to see that. That's not right. It's not right for a woman to show her body. Hey, let me go ahead and say it. It's summertime. It's not right for a woman to reveal her body. When I wait, preacher, it's okay, man. If I go to the beach now, I gotta, what you going, look, you putting on your underwear and walk around in front of people. Again, somebody's got to say it. Might as well be the preacher. There ain't no amens. I'm not expecting amens this morning. Because, hey, you know why? God's people have grown so accustomed to loving the world and looking like the world. And no preacher, nobody cries out against it. To where when one does, you go home now or you eat lunch and you're like, oh, preacher, gotta love him. And you laugh it off. It's not the preacher you're laughing off. You're laughing off God's word. It's not the preacher you're that's just preacher. You know, him and his family, that's good for him. Well, truth is, I thought it's good for God's people. I thought loving God more than loving the world is good for God's people. See, because when I read my Bible, he said, don't love it. He said, don't look like it. But over in 2 Corinthians chapter 6, he said, be ye not unequally yoked together with unbelievers. And he goes to laying all this out, finally gets down a few verses later, he says this, wherefore, come out from among them and be ye separate, saith the Lord, and touch not the unclean thing. He says, I don't want you to love the world. I don't want you to look like the world. I tell you what else, I don't want you to linger with the world. If you put a clean towel in the load of dirty towels, are you about to make all the other towels clean? Yes or no? What are you about to do? You're about to dirty up the clean towel. God's people. Now, look, I'm going to go reach the world. I'm going to tell the world about Christ. But I cannot fellowship and spend time out there. Hey, man, y'all going to be drinking, hooping, hollering, cussing, all that. Maybe I'm going to bring me and my kids over. We're coming over. I'm about to linger. And if I linger, preacher, anyway, you may not leave out of there cussing. Yeah, but what about when Jonathan says, what's this word mean, Daddy? And he tells me, because I put him around those that do it.
Amen, preacher.
I did.
Amen.
Daddy did. Daddy put him around it. Daddy put his son around the world. And now and by the way, I'm about to produce a worldly son. Put your son around other worldly boys. Hey, put them in a worldly church.
Amen.
I tell you, all that, every once in a while, preacher, I tell you, that's just too narrow, man. You preach too hard on stuff. So where are you going? Someplace where they preach it easy? Let's go put the kids around the easy stuff. She won't have to worry about the preacher preaching on anything hard.
Amen.
You know, I mean, come on, all that worldly stuff is almost convicting mom and daddy. Making mom and daddy look bad.
Amen.
Because the kids, they're listening to the preaching and they come home, you know, don't be like the kid that came home and said, guess what I learned in church today, hypocrite. But they're coming home. Hey, going to be something whenever the kids go to learning something and they're like, that's worldly, ain't it, daddy? Daddy's doing it. Now, wait, why do you preach like this? You preach like this because you believe that people can love God more than they can love the world. They can love the Lord.
Amen.
Guess what? Some things need to change, don't they?
Right.
Just need to change. It's not a bad change either. It's the right change.
Yeah.
It's a good change. I noticed when the Lord began to work in my life and I began to surrender things to the Lord and the Lord began convicted me of the stuff I was doing. Here, if He's convicted you this morning, good, let Him. But don't let it just stay at, well, God dealt with my heart. I'm glad I began to act on what God was dealing with me about. You see, because the goal is not just, you know, over in Psalm 78, the Bible says that we want to raise children who set their hope in God.
Yep.
The opposite of that is children in whom is no faith. I don't even have time. You know what? I want to preach on the flesh a little while because the world, the flesh, and the devil. Flesh, our worst enemy is us. The worst enemy we have is our own carnal nature, that flesh. By the way, your flesh craves the world. It craves all that old stuff. If I'm not careful when I go to prayer, here, I'll just use, I was cutting up about the music. There you go. Somebody say, when I start preaching about music, the Bible says speaking to yourselves in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. Preacher, all you listen to is gospel? Oh, and by the way, I listen to old-fashioned gospel, not this contemporary mess either. Why do I want... by the way, come on now. Here's all we're doing if we call it contemporary. If we put worldly music with Christian words in it, hey, isn't that trying to satisfy some kind of worldly appetite we have? Let's get the rest of them going. Preacher, that's just so old-fashioned. Bible. Bible. Here it is. The Bible says, you know, the Bible says this matter of walking in the old paths, He says, wherein is the good way? Now, I just say this. It's not all, preacher, old-fashioned. That's old. No. What would change what changed the Hopkins family is when, number one, Jesus passed by. But I had a preacher that preached like I'm preaching this morning. Man, Preacher Moore would preach the devil out of everything I was doing. And I'd get convicted every service, go down to the altar, and you know what? God would get something else. God would get something else. But this matter of your flesh, hey, your flesh craves the world. Satan knows that. Satan is using the external and the internal just to attack God's people. With the world, don't love it. with the world, don't look like it. With the world, don't linger with it. But when it comes to the flesh, the only thing you can do with the flesh is to crucify your flesh. I'm not going to deal with that. I may deal with it tonight. I may deal with it another time where I just preach a message just on the flesh. That may be good. If the Lord be pleased with that, amen. Because tonight, get ready tonight. Now, I know I've already been preaching like, I ain't coming back today. You better come back tonight. You better come in. You better be here. You know why? I'm dealing with it. This is the, you know what happened a year ago this week? Year ago this week? Boom! Law of the land! Gay marriage. Bunch of gay marriage. You know, it's okay. Hook them up. Men with men, women with women. There's been a little less than 200,000 of them across the nation in 1 year's time. Again, I don't, look, people ask you about that. What do you think? Oh, man, I can't say anything. I mean, man, the day we live, somebody's going to, you know. Well, all I can say on that end of it is I'd like to give you a biblical account. I'm not just preaching on that. Here's what I'm going to preach on. And this will help you men if you want to be a Christian man. I'm preaching on the matter of being a man tonight. Yeah. Being a man. Yep. By the way, a real man will come to church on Sunday night. Yep. Mm. I'm a real man. I'm not coming. See you later. I'm kidding with you. I'm not kidding. Here. I ought not say that. The Bible says, not forsaking the assembling of yourselves together as the manner of some is. Amen. But exhorting one another, and so much more as you see the day approaching. I should exhort you to be here. I'm exhorting you. I'm encouraging you to be here. I'm going to preach on men. Men need preaching on men. We need that. I need that. You need that. I said men need preaching on being a man. This is not an attack on your manhood. This is helping you be a better man, a godly man. It's showing you what the Bible says. So if you be here tonight, let God help. By the way, ladies, if you want that kind of man, then you ought to make him come with you. That'd be good. It'd be a blessing. Any man ought to want to improve and be a better Christian. Any man ought to want to be a better husband. Any man ought to want to be a better daddy. Any man ought to want to be a better whatever we are. Now, don't get mad at me, my crowd, that you got work and you can't be here, or you're already going to be gone. And I'm not saying that. I want you here because you get help. But this morning, you got to understand, you're safe. You're saved by the grace of God. Devil's after you. Man, that devil hates it, and he's going to use the external and the internal. He'll use the world and the flesh. A two-sided attack. He has you flanked on both sides. But you and I, according to the Word of God, we can overcome that. We can love God, not love the world. We can look like God, not look like the world. We can linger with God's people and not the world. This matter of the flesh, there's four things that when I preach on this, I'll use the Spirit of God, the Word of God, the Son of God, and the armor of God. There's four verses that talk about the flesh and how we can overcome the flesh, our wicked flesh. And all four of those things are what God uses to do that. I want you to bow your head and close your eyes. How many of you say, preacher, with all my heart, I want to be godly and not worldly? I realize it's worth fighting for to be godly. Raise your hand. Raise it up.
Thank you for choosing to watch this sermon preached at Heritage Baptist Church. Heritage Baptist Church is located at 1843 Peeksville Road, Locust Grove, Georgia, 30248. You can contact us at 770-320-7771. Visit us on the web at www.hbcga.com.